Idleman Unplugged is part of the Edify podcast network.
I want to see your face pass me by the crowds of people, the priest who sing your praise.
Hello, my name is Shane Idleman, and I'm the pastor of Westside Christian Fellowship in Leona Valley, California. It is my personal heart and goal for you to see truth through a biblical perspective. I hope that you enjoy this segment of Idleman Unplugged.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Idleman Unplugged. I am your host, Luke Duncan, and on this episode of the podcast, Pastor Shane joins Dr. Jim Garlow and Dr. Malachi O'Brien to discuss Westside Christian Fellowship's Rend the Heavens services. We hope that you enjoy this segment of Idleman Unplugged.
A hunger and thirst for your righteousness, and it's only found.
Mario Bromnick is not able to be on with us tonight. He's our host from the East Coast. My name is Jim Garlow. I'm the host from the West Coast with my wife, Rosemary. Now, she's further north up the coast. She's in the San Francisco Bay Area right now and is not able to be on the call with us. But however, Malachi O'Brien, he's always there filling in. Malachi, you and I are going to have the privilege of introducing the speaker tonight who's going to share right now. So I'm going to start it off and then you just finishing up, introduce the speaker. Is that okay, Malachi?
Sounds great, Jim. Looking forward to it.
Shane Idleman is a friend of mine, a friend of Malachi's, friend of probably many of you. Pastor is just, if you could go to Los Angeles and go up over the hills, just north part of Los Angeles, go up those high hills and on the other side of those mountains, you'd be in a beautiful community called Palmdale. And that area right there is a spectacular valley out west. It's out with cows pasturing and such. And then you come to a vibrant church where people drive considerable distances to come to that church. I've had the privilege of preaching there a number of times. It is on fire. Now, part of the purposes of the World Prayer Network is to keep you up to speed on a whole lot of issues governmentally, politically, morally, ethically, et cetera, but also to bring you reports of revival and renewal. And Malachi, you've brought a number of your friends from some of the points of revival taking place in Georgia and Tennessee. We're going to hear a report tonight that's going to really encourage you where every once in a while, God's hand touches earth. My graduate studies are in the area of church history, and I've kind of focused for many, many years on the issues of the outbreaks of God, the renewal moments, the revivals that have taken place. So it's really fun to get to hear a present tense story of something that's happening right now in a local congregation that has broken out where God has touched earth in a significant way that is literally transforming lives, where unrighteousness is being broken, where healing is coming on sickened bodies, where deliverance is coming to traumatized souls, and people are being touched by the presence of the living God. Shane Idleman is the pastor and shepherd of this incredible move of God right now. We're going to go to him in a moment, but he's also a special friend of Malachi O'Brien. Malachi, help complete the introduction of Shane Idleman before we turn it over to him.
Thank you, Jim. And I appreciate you giving me this point of personal privilege. I've had the joy to know Shane for a couple of years now. And I would just say, and this is not an exaggeration. Shane to me is a modern day mix of Tozer and Ravenhill together. And so, you know, there's very few Sunday mornings, Jim, that I don't get a text from Shane, and see a picture of 80, 90 people that have gathered at 6 a.m. at their church to worship and pray. You find me a church in America where that many people have gathered the service before the service to go after the Lord, you'll be hard pressed. Churches that are in revival are led by pastors who are convinced it's the only hope. And I know Shane has been bold all in California of all places through COVID. Taking the stand, Jim, is in some ways, he may not say this, but it's cost him people in his church. But I say at the same time, it's been attractive to people looking for courage and boldness. And so one of the things I love, Jim, is that, I mean, he lives this creed out. I mean, I think Shane just lives between fasting and just praying. And somewhere in between of that, he does maybe a few other things. But I would encourage everybody tonight, in just a moment, you're going to hear the Spirit speak through a man that's hungry for God. If you get a chance, go check out shaneidleman.com. His articles are on revival and awakening in the church. Check out his YouTube channel by the same name, Shane Eidelman. Again, tonight we're going to hear from a modern day revivalist who probably gets a little unnerved by this high praise, I'm sure. But I'm excited. We've been trying to get Shane on the call for a while now, so here he is. So, Jim, thank you. One of my dearest friends in the world, Shane Eidelman. Tonight's a special call. You guys can enjoy this. So with that, Jim, I turn it back over to you.
Well, and Shane, if you would, as you come on, tell a little bit about yourself. I think that'd be good for them to know, if you don't mind. I know you're going to want to focus not on yourself, but let them know a little bit of your story as a bodybuilder, as a nutrition expert, too. A little bit of your background, and then go right into what has exploded in the fires of God when they've touched your community and your church there. We introduce you, Shane Eidelman. Take it away, brother.
I love that. Thanks, Jim. Can you hear me okay?
We can.
I feel like I'm preaching to the choir here, but sometimes the choir needs a little encouragement as well. All of you are probably well-versed on revival and what that looks like, what that means. There's a hunger for it. There's a desire for it. But to back up a little bit, what Jim was saying, I was actually born here, right here where this church is at in this community in Los Angeles County of all places. So we've got Governor Newsom in addition to the Board of Supervisors of LA County. And I was born here and I was raised here. Barely graduated high school with a 1.8. I had a speech and learning disability, dyslexia, and just a lot of brokenness from that, an angry home. A father wasn't a Christian from the farms of Oklahoma. And so just hard work and construction and just been here all my life. And I began to run from God and obviously the party scene and alcohol, drugs, all kinds of things. And started working for 24-hour fitness of all places, as Jim alluded to. And worked my way up the corporate ladder, but it cost me a great deal because I was chasing everything but God. But with that came a lot of knowledge on health and fitness. And I did abuse steroids, of course, and just my life was just out of control, the prodigal son story. And around age 29, God completely broke me. And I turned my life just 100%. I remember the house. I remember the room. I remember the floor. I remember the carpet where I just cried out to God and just the filling of the Holy Spirit was something I've never experienced before. The word of God came alive. Worship music came alive. It was just incredible filling of the Holy Spirit. And then from that, started to read books on systematic theology. And I've read a lot of books and just that's how I educated myself. A lot of Jim Garlow's books, John MacArthur's books, systematic theology, Wayne Grudem, Charles Spurgeon, you name it. But during this time, I had when God calls you, he'll give you each different desires often. You know, for the homeless, for abortion, for ministry, for teaching, he began to give me a love for our nation, how it was founded, and reading a lot of the Puritans, reading, of course, David Barton and Jim's books, and studying American history and just seeing how far we have drifted from the truth. Went to the California Renewal Projects, and this hunger, this fire was welling up inside of me. And usually that's a good thing. That means God wants to direct that fire in a certain direction. But with that came the desire for revival. And so reading just a love revival books, all the books from the Welsh revivals of actually the 1700s, men like Daniel Rowlands, Hal Harris, Griffin Jones. And then you go into the Welsh revivals and New Hebrides revivals and Duncan Campbell and Evan Roberts and the First Great Awakening. And my heartbeat is for revival. And I'd be praying for many years, God, would you bring that here? And so what we're experiencing actually is years and years of perseverance and pushing in and pressing in. And you can't whip revival up, but God can bring it down from heaven, I believe, when certain conditions are met. And so our church set out for October to be October fast. So many people are fasting. And our key verse was, oh, Lord, would you rend the heavens in Isaiah? And that word really is rip open. God, would you rip open the heavens? And with that, though, we have to prepare the soil of our heart. And we begin to just clean hands and a pure heart and humility. And there is a desire. There's an intensity. It's a commitment and it's travail. Prayer is often travail and battling and revival and contending for that. And we have, you know, I'm not a big, I love prophetic words. I believe in them, but I have the John MacArthur Study Bible. So I consider myself conservative, but God blew my conservative mind apart when he began to rend the heavens. We've been getting kind of the prophetic words over the years. Even Glenn Shepherd, I don't know if many of you know Glenn Shepherd, Malachi Might, and others were just saying, man, God's doing something here. Just prepare your people and get ready for this. And God's going to honor your intensity and your fire, your hunger for years and a decade. And so it's been growing and culminating and just building. And so we said, okay, the last week of October, we're just going to meet every single night. And the first night was Monday, about 300 people showed up. And it was just something amazing, something we haven't experienced before, where the altar is completely full. There's no room. And then Monday turns into a Tuesday and a Wednesday and a Thursday. And then people are being delivered and set free. And we had demonic manifestations on Wednesday night. This man was just crying out to God. He gave his testimony last night. And then four other people delivered in the last 5 days, and people being little healing. And I'm going and talking to them about being healed and set free and the joy of the Lord, and testimonies coming in all over. And so there's this fire of God that's been going, and we decided to keep it going another week. So this is actually the final night tonight. I'm about 23 services in a row. I preached 15 times in 2 weeks. And just, we're honoring God's word, because different revivals have different themes. Evan Roberts was mainly testimonies and hymnals, where we feel the inerrancy of scripture and the foundation of scripture, and highlighting God's word again, and getting back to trembling before God, and the fear of the Lord is not in this place in America. And so just elevating God's word and elevating worship and camping out, not being in a hurry. Services are usually about 3 hours long. And it's just amazing what God is doing. Now, me and my associate pastor, who's been very instrumental, we both have 5 kids, all under 16. So I think, you know, God is pouring out a measure of revival in these desperate times, like Ezra, giving us a measure of revival in our bondage. America is bound, and we are hell bent. But I think God is looking for men and women, again, preaching to the choir, who will do what it takes. Give us clean hands and a pure heart. God, would you rend the heavens? Would you fast? And there's a desperation. There's a, like childbirth, that travail, when Zion travail, sons and daughters are born. And there's, God, if you don't rip open heaven, we are lost. I don't want to play church. I've been praying that for years. I don't want to play church. We came here to meet the risen God. And so sometimes I'll go up to walk to the pulpit, the altar's already full. Or I won't even give an altar call. And people are already starting to come to the altar, and the worship team is sometimes on their knees and there's tears. They can't finish a song. And it's just amazing to see what God is doing. I'd love to just keep going, but we are at a point of exhaustion. Dr. Michael Brown is a friend of mine. So obviously he's been giving me some encouragement there, and just ride the wave and see what God wants to do. We believe it's a turning point. We believe it's God's going to just keep pouring out his spirit. We've got people driving, like Jim said, Huntington Beach, up the coast, Oxnard, Arizona, Oregon. Somebody just drove 2 hours Thursday night. Their dad is not a believer. He's old. He's about 80 years old. He was watching the live stream this morning, and I was preaching on the ark and the ark of safety. When God's wrath is poured out around us, we can jump into the ark of hope in Christ. And he gave his heart to the Lord this morning watching the live stream, but he was touched, he said, Thursday night by the testimonies. So it's just that we actually had to set up a page, a survey for all the testimonies coming in. I've never seen anything like what God has done in 2 weeks in such a short amount of time, maybe a couple of years. And maybe many churches don't experience that I've apologized to the congregation, because I've been a hindrance to revival. And God showed me many years ago that he's basically said, Shane, you don't want revival. It will ruin your schedule. It will ruin your image around others of being a man who is well balanced and controlling the services. But when God breaks out, when the Holy Spirit does something, you might as well try to contain Niagara Falls. It's just incredible. So anyway, I'm fully aware of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. We believe in the Holy Spirit's power, and just the overcoming during preaching, where sometimes the filling of the Spirit and begin to just weep for our nation. It's just amazing the atmosphere that God has been doing here the last 2 weeks.
I'm going to ask if we can ask some questions. Malachi, I'm going to turn to you first, and then Judy, we're going to do something a little unusual. I'm going to ask you, there's a number of intercessors that pray for this call for an hour before it comes on. Yeah. I don't think we've ever done this before, but I want the intercessors to unmute and have their video cameras on, and I want them to feel free to ask questions of Shana. This is, oftentimes we read something historically, but this is present tense. So it's really unique to get to talk to a man who's in the very midst of this kind of a move of God. Malachi, I'm going to start with you. what questions you have for Shane. And then I'm not looking at Facebook, but I'm not able to right now. But I don't know if somebody, one of the intercessors, if you're able to watch the questions off of Facebook and bring those to Shane, that would be excellent if we could do that. So Judy, if one of them, you can text one of them and see if they're able to watch that, or Greg, if you're able to, whoever can. Malachi, I'm going to go to you. So we kind of tap into this report here right now. And what my hope and prayer is that this will release faith across America in many local congregations that God could do something in other places. Go right ahead, Malachi.
Okay. So Shane, just pretend for 1 second that you had a chance to say something to the audience. Was every pastor in the nation, if you had that, I mean, I know this is kind of one of those hypothetical questions, but I want you to give us your heart. I want everyone, all the intercessors, I want those that watch us on Facebook. What do you think, if you could say something to every pastor, there's pastors on this call, and then there's intercessors on this call. What would you say to pastors in this hour of history? What would that be, especially in regards to this topic of revival?
That's actually pretty easy. Just the blessing of brokenness. And I would really focus in on humility, because it takes broken men to break men. And the anointing of the Holy Spirit cannot come from prideful, arrogant men who have their sermons down, who think they're worried about numbers and status and recognition. I mean, that's why many pastors are not preaching boldly, because they don't want to lose numbers. They don't want to lose, and they're pleasing men. I know it's a challenge. So my heart would be to just encourage humiliation and humbling themselves and desperation. There's a hunger. There's a crying out to God. That's a cry He will hear. When I hear my child across the yard in the backyard crying, "Daddy, help me," that's a cry that God will hear. And getting His people, His pastors, His shepherds, to be watchmen again. And they have got to lead the way. They've got to be the broken, humble servants, desperate for more God. Even when they don't see it, I don't see revival, I don't feel it. What's happening? Well, faith is the evidence of things not seen. And that pleases God. So it would be just the blessing of brokenness and complete surrender and humility, and not worrying about what people will think. I mean, we've done surveys, how many pastors are worried about losing more people? They're worried about offending the government. They don't want to get political. Well, the Bible's political. See what they're lacking. I'm actually, you're going to help me with this next article, the incredible shrinking church in America. Why are so many churches shrinking, but bold churches are growing? We've had to add another service. We're close to 1,000 people at this church that was losing people, moving out of California, and the finances are, everything's increasing, because God is honoring those who step out in boldness. But boldness comes directly from the Holy Spirit. It can't come from arrogance. It can't come from telling people off. It can't come from let them hear the wonderful sermon I'm going to preach, and just complete time with God in the prayer closet. And, you know, our gun safes are full, but our prayer closets are empty. I think that's half the problem.
Well said.
I would like to ask Michael Brown, who you referred to, is a great historian of revivals and certainly helped in the Brownsville revival enormously. He shepherded that. What counsel and advice did he give you in the midst of this? And then have the nightly services, I'm trying to understand here, have those concluded? And how many, say once again, how long those services went on? Have those concluded at this time and ended? And what was Michael's counsel and advice to you as you helped guide this really spontaneous move of God?
Yeah, two things pop out. That we're talking with Dr. Brown, and, you know, I text him, he's able to get back to me fairly soon, is when we were planning, you know, do we keep going? He really just said, you know, you're going to have to ride the wave and not try to plan or think what you think God wants you to do. Ride the wave. If there's a desire, if there's a need, open the church. If not, take a day off. You know, just be sensitive to what God wants to do, because you can, Malachi knows, he's got a PhD in marketing. And I was a marketing director, 24-hour fitness, branding and marketing, and get it in their face and billboards and campaigning. You can do a lot of that, but a good thing isn't always a God thing. You can get the people here, but is God here? And so we want to ride that wave. We want to see, Lord, what are you doing, and being sensitive to that? I mean, Wednesday night, I didn't know to I mean, I don't know what to do. This guy is manifesting. He's hitting the stage. He's being delivered. He's sweating. We've got a prayer team around him. We're just worshiping. Speak the name of Jesus. The congregation's praying for him, and he's set free. He's testifying. Now, normally I'd say, uh-oh, what's going on here? I don't know if we can allow that, right? And so just being open to what God wants to do, riding that wave. And also, I think the thing that really helped the most, what I didn't realize is the revival. The highs are anything, are like anything you felt before, wanting to go to church on a Tuesday and a Wednesday and a Thursday and a Friday. There's a desire to go to church. It's tremendous, but there's big lows, and the demonic activity that we have faced, I would not have been prepared for this. The whole day today, I'm dealing with legality issues and maybe involving law enforcement. We didn't have to. And then water lines breaking, the camera system going down, the electrical grid is busting, and we've got people harassing the church. It's just like unbelievable the amount of demonic opposition that is out there. And so that really helped to prepare me for, okay, this is part of the journey whenever God is moving. So there's correctional officers at the altar with felons. There's marriages being restored. We were counseling them not to get a divorce a month and a half ago. Now they're at the altar. But then you've got all kinds of other things going on demonically where spouses are fighting, they're mad at the church. And it's like, I've never experienced this amount of attack in such a short amount of time. So that advice from him really helped to prepare that. But to answer your question, we want to go a whole week, and we just continued again. Now we're at the next week. We're at the week number two. This is the 14th day. The last service is tonight, 6 o'clock. I'm going to go out there when this is over and just see what God wants to do. But people are hungry for more of God. So if we start to say, okay, every day, because you had a man on here, Murray, I don't know his first name, from, is it New Zealand?
Yes, Christchurch, New Zealand, Murray Watkinson.
Yeah, that really inspired me. Like you said, it's contagious. That inspired me. And I took it to Lord, and Lord, you know, just put on my heart to do this. But he's able to go every single day. So I don't want to go, oh, well, we want to do that too. We should do that too. I'm like, Lord, whatever you want to do, because I don't want to lose my family. I don't want to lose my sanity. I haven't been to my kids' gymnastics or my sports, and laundry's piled up. Lord, what does this look like? So God is practical. And I think he's just going to, the Wednesday nights, if we do Saturday nights, we start at 7 a.m. Sunday morning service because of the hunger of the people. And so we're just kind of following, okay, Lord, where are you at? What are you doing? And just being sensitive to that, if that makes sense.
You're exactly right. You don't have to do what Murray Watkinson or anybody else does. You do what God directs you. So just understanding, you've had how many, when did you start the services? How long?
Well, October 24th was three services on Sunday, and then we just kept going on Monday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night. So it's just every night at 6 until tonight. Three services on Sunday and Sunday night. So four services on Sunday. And it's just been, building ever since. Now, granted, with the demonic attacks, I've never seen more people come down with COVID in the last 2 days from our church or sick. It's just five ushers are out, deacons are out, elders are out, worship team members. It's like unbelievable. And so you see this momentum, but you see the enemy trying to do whatever he can to stop that. So we're on night 14 of this going on, and we don't want to overtax ourselves. I think God gives us wisdom. You know, we don't have anything to prove. And just the fact that people are coming and being transformed, because the normal church service now is one song, a couple announcements, three songs. Let's get the sermon at 30 minutes because the attention span is waning, followed by one song and let's go eat lunch. And that's not going to work in these dire times. We need to get leaders pressing in and pulling down heaven and leading by example. I'm actually have the privilege of speaking at Rob McCoy's church at the end of this month for all three of his services. So I'm hoping to bring some of this type of revival fire there as well.
One of the marks of revival is not only is the intensity of the enemy's attack, and that's true. That's true. Every single time when the intensity of the Lord's favor is upon something, then the enemy attack. We certainly get that. But revivals are, and you've already described it, revivals, John Wimber's a guy who really taught me this. Revivals are messy. They're historically just kind of messy. And you have to learn to manage and flow within that and relax and allow God to do what he's going to do and really not worry about some of the repercussions you might ordinarily be concerned about and allow God to do his work, and he'll you'll see it through. I don't want to be the only one. I have so many questions, but I want to make sure I defer to those who are online with me. I see a question here is, people are wanting to know, are your services being live streamed? So tell them where they can go to live stream, however long this might continue. So tell us that first.
Yeah, it's at Westside Christian Fellowship on YouTube, Westside Christian Fellowship. And the services are live. Actually, the Wednesday service, you can hear the demonic manifestation or after almost close to 2 hours. But I just feel honored to be able to answer these questions. I don't feel qualified. I don't have an education, the background of theology. I mean, I study a lot of, but it's just God uses those who are hungry. He's no respecter of persons. He's a respecter of principles. And I do have friends. I'm not going to name a seminary that's here close by in LA down there, but they are so, see, you can be Bible taught, but not spirit led. You can be straight as a gun barrel theologically, but just as empty. We need the truth of God's word and the power of the spirit married together. That is bold preaching. And D. Martin Lloyd-Jones said, preaching is really theology coming from a man who's on fire for God. And actually the last chapter of his book, Preaching on Preaching, or Preachers and Preaching, he talked about the unction, the dire need of unction in the pulpit today. You can call it the baptism, you can call it the fire, you can call it the anointing, you can call it the unction, you better have it. And that's the key, I think, really right now to sparking revival. You know what, Jim, this is going to be interesting. I read books like you do. I love books. 100 years ago, it was interesting when they would call a pastor to the pastorate. Many churches, they would never ask, where did you get your degree? Although that's important. I love education. It's important. They would ask, has he received his baptism of fire? Has he been anointed and called by God to preach the good news of Jesus Christ? Is the fire burning within him? Is that anointing of the Holy Spirit that's going to make the prodigal son come home? It's going to comfort the single mom. It's going to convict. The word of God is convicting, and like a sharp double-edged sword, it's piercing. And we need that boldness right now. It's in these dire times, these soft sermons and this comforting and up calling people out of sin is not going to spark anything even remotely close to revival. Because in addition to prayer starting revival, so does repentance. Repentance and calling out sin and loving the holiness of God and the fear of God.
That's one of the things I just so love and respect about you. I've followed your sermons for some time, but you have not capitulated and compromised in this culture, and that's why God is so honoring you. One of the questions on Facebook, could you share some of what you're speaking to or what you're addressing with your church? I recognize that changes from night to night. That's one of the questions that just popped in. Somebody sent it to me. And do congregations need to encourage pastors to spend more time in their prayer closet? I think I know the answer to that question, but I'm going to let you respond. Then are people bringing people by word of mouth? I suspect I know the answer to that, but you respond to those questions, and then we're going to open it.
I can do all three briefly. Usually I've been getting up in the morning, and I've had a pattern. Thank God for my construction hours, because it's got a pattern of getting up at four in the morning. So I've got the first 3 hours are just prayer and worship, reading God's word every day, pouring it for the last 20 years. And so whatever text jumps out at me and the principles, and I begin to put that sermon together, and if it's burning in my heart, there's a good chance it's going to burn out in the congregation. And so getting that direction. So I've been teaching last night was get used to different. When God moves, get used to different. This morning was on the fear of God. We don't tremble anymore. And talking about the founding of our nation and the importance of fear of God. And so it just depends on the topic. Sometimes it's just worship, a worship night, and testimonies of what God is doing. The testimonies are absolutely incredible. And as far as I personally would not go to your pastor and tell them they need to pray more. You need to pray more. You need to fast, and you need to allow God to change his heart through your intercession. Because many people aren't open to you going to them and telling them they need to pray for it. Take it to God and intercede on behalf of that pastor. And I believe the fires will fall when we start to, we are given the gift of intercession. We are given the gift to intercede for our nation. Look at Ezra, look at Nehemiah, look at Moses. It's just down. Jesus was the most powerful intercessor that we've ever known. And so the gift of intercession. But did I miss one of those questions?
No, but I've asked this one other question. One of the things I've noticed that tends to be present in most of the Great Awakenings revival is people come I'm not trying to be mystical, but I'm trying to be very practical when I say this. They come to an awareness of the holiness of God. Mm-hmm. And when you see, it's kind of like Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 6. When he saw the holiness of God, he realized how unholy he was, and that drove him to repentance. To what extent, and this may not be a characteristic of what's happening there, but to what extent is there an awareness of the righteousness or the holiness of God that is gripping people and driving them into a spirit of repentance?
Oh, that is without a shadow of doubt. The altar's full every night. Sometimes backed up, and people, you can hear them crying, you can hear them moaning, you can hear God just breaking their heart. And Jim, as you know, genuine revival is the Holy Spirit genuinely moving. And if the Holy Spirit is genuinely moving, the difficult truths of the Bible, what we consider difficult, are going to be elevated. Repentance, the blood of Christ, the inerrancy of Scripture, the judgment of God, the fear of the Lord, all those will be elevated because the Holy Spirit is moving and breaking and convicting and changing and altering. You can't change the heart without confronting it. So it's the fear of the Lord, reverence and respect and awe is just, we have people that are, they'll come in and they're just so convicted, they leave. Or they'll come, they'll park, and I just feel this weight of God. And I don't know what's happening. And they'll begin to cry before they get into the sanctuary. So that heaviness is always attributed to the fear. I mean, I love the love of God. Thank God for the grace of God. If it wasn't for the grace of God, I wouldn't be here. But we have so erred on the side of grace that we've forgotten the other side of the coin. And that being repentance and the judgment of God and the holiness of God. God is not just love. He has all of his attributes are equal. He's a God of justice, of holiness, of righteousness, and of love. So yes, the fear of God has been elevated beyond anything we've seen before.
If you've enjoyed this episode of Idleman Unplugged, be sure to send us your ideas and topics for future episodes of the podcast. You can send us an email at westsidechristianfellowship.org. or ShaneIdleman.com. Again, my name is Luke Duncan, and I am your host of Idleman Unplugged. Thank you for listening to us today, and join us again on the next episode.
Thank you for listening to Idleman Unplugged. For more information, visit us at ShaneIdleman.com. Again, that's ShaneIdleman.com.
This podcast is part of the Edify Podcast Network. Edify is a faith-inspiring app that brings together thousands of the best Christian podcasts in one place for your listening enjoyment. Cut through the noise and grow your faith by diving into the world's top Christian podcasts today. Download the Edify app for free from the App Store or Google Play, or by going to edify.app. That's edifi.app.
El Paseo Publications proudly supports the Westside Christian Fellowship Radio Network. We are committed to quality in Christian publication. Free ebooks can be found at westsidechristianfellowship.org under free ebooks. Books such as What Works for Men and What Works for Young Adults will help readers understand that the obstacles ahead are never greater than God's power to take you through. Books such as What Works When Diets Don't and Feasting and Fasting demonstrate how health can be achieved from a biblical perspective. Other free books such as Answers for a Confused Church and Desperate for More of God show the importance of fully surrendering our lives to Christ. And One Nation Above God is a must-read for anyone concerned about the direction of America. Again, free downloads of these ebooks are available at westsidechristianfellowship.org. We are happy about partnering with the Westside Christian Fellowship Radio Network.